Well, this is about what's new in bUnit for .NET 6, but let me quickly introduce myself before we get to that. So, hi, I'm Eagle, and I have the pleasure of working for this awesome company in Denmark called Delegate. It's an IT consultancy. I'm also a Microsoft MVP, but I guess more importantly for this talk, I'm the creator of bUnit, and you know, if you like what you see here today, you can also watch me. I try to stream weekly on Twitch. So if you kind of, you know, want to see more of me, I don't know why you would, but if you like, you can definitely do that and join me there on Twitch. And if you have any questions now, or if you're watching this in the future, feel free to tweet at me from you know, on Twitter at my tag there and ask your questions. I'm always happy to answer questions. Okay, so with that out of the way, let me just briefly disclaim this talk by saying, you know, I kind of assume you know Blazor, and you also should be sort of familiar with unit testing principles. I'm not going to cover that. So this is about, you know, deep diving into how can we actually unit test our Blazor components. So what is bUnit? Well, bUnit need to get my timer going so I actually know how much time I'm using. Yeah, so yeah, bUnit is a library for testing Blazor components, and I'm going to highlight the word library there because bUnit is not a general purpose testing framework. So a general purpose testing framework would be something like XUnit or NUnit, and you create a, you know, test project with those, and then you add libraries on top of that to help your testing. That could be Fluent Assertions or N-Substitute or MOQ, but it could also be bUnit if you wanted to test Blazor components. So bUnit sort of falls into the category of libraries you add on top of your existing testing infrastructure. So that also means that bUnit tests look and feel just like regular unit tests written in C#. So there's nothing special about them. They will feel much, very much like that. And everywhere where you can run your XUnit project, for example, you can also run bUnit tests. So that's great. That also, again, means that you can reuse all the testing patterns and practices you've built up over time. So all the good tricks and tips you have for creating maintainable tests and refactorable and everything, you know, that still works with bUnit. Same principles apply here. So one thing I want to highlight that bUnit doesn't do that might surprise newcomers to bUnit is that bUnit doesn't run a web browser. So I think on day one, we saw some introduction to some of the new testing features in Visual Studio, and they talked about Playwright, how that will spin up a browser and run your tests in that browser and then, you know, record the results and so on and so forth. But bUnit doesn't do that. bUnit runs entirely in C#. And that also means it doesn't run your JavaScript. So if you have a very JavaScript-heavy component that you want to test that uses a lot of JavaScript, then you might want to use Playwright or something like that. But if you just want to test your, or you primarily have C# in your Blazor components, well, then bUnit is perfect for that. And you can still verify that your component does the right thing in terms of talking to JavaScript, because we do have a built-in JavaScript interrupt in bUnit that allows you to sort of set up expectations similar to how you can do things with mocking. But the advantage of not running in the browser is that bUnit test runs incredibly fast, and they're also very predictable, just like regular unit tests. So there's no waiting for the browser, waiting for content to appear on screen and stuff like that. You have full control of that. So it's like regular unit testing, basically. So the question I'm setting out to ask is, what's new in bUnit for .NET 6? But I'm going to steal this slide from Daniel Ruff, also day one, where he showed some of the things, a lot of the things that are new in Blazor for .NET 6. And many of the things here actually doesn't really influence bUnit, because bUnit runs if you're using an XUnit test project, it runs in that regular .NET runtime. So a lot of the things around WebAssembly, AOT, runtime, relinking, all that stuff, that doesn't really influence how bUnit works. So that was, you know, a nice surprise for me. So if we throw some of those things away, we are left with things like this that bUnit should support. And it turns out that bUnit more or less already did that before, you know, did .NET 6 even started shipping. So that's sort of a testament to how, you know, the Blazor team was able to deliver a .NET 6 version of Blazor without even breaking some of the, let's call it popternal parts of bUnit, of Blazor that bUnit relies on, even for a new major release. So that's kind of awesome. So, I guess I should still show a demo, even though there's maybe not a lot of .NET specific things, because there are new things in bUnit. So let's jump into a demo, and I'm going to see if I can follow Steve's example and just do mostly demos for this presentation. So without further ado, well, let me close this one down. Let's start by looking at the demo project I've set up for us here. So I'm going to expand these and zoom in a bit. So we have three projects in this example here. We have a sample app, we have a sample component, and some sample tests. So let me click on this just so you can see. This is just a Blazor WebAssembly .NET 6 Blazor WebAssembly application. The component library is just a Razor component library. So that's sort of something that you would put, you know, components in that you would reuse across projects perhaps. And our test project, for this I'm using XUnit. So if you created a .NET 6 XUnit project, you will recognize all of these bits. They are the same. Something you might not recognize is this bit here. This is the bUnit packages. And another thing I've done as well is I've changed the project type to Microsoft.NET.SDK.Razor because we want to write Razor files in our test project. So that's all we have. And before we get started, let me see if I can power up the application. And I was able to do that. So the application is this simple sample app here, and it should look familiar to anybody who's done any Blazor. And we have, for example, the counter page. And as we all know, when you click the click me button, you get another count here, another increment of the count. So let's just start with very like the hello world of demos for bUnit. How do we test something like this? So let's jump back to our code and close this bit down here and go to the first counter test. So in here, we have a regular XUnit test class with a single test method in it. But one thing I have done to make things easier for us is I've added this method as the base method for the test class. So test context is a bUnit thing that allows us to render components to do other things. So in this case, we are using the render component method from the test context to render the counter component, what we just saw on screen before. The result of that is a rendered fragment. And with that, we can go ahead and interrogate things about that rendered component. We can go ahead and ask it, well, we can go and inspect the document object model that, or the markup that the counter component created. So what are we going to do here is, well, we wanted to emulate clicking on that button and then see the count increment. So what we do is we go ahead and use this find method that takes a CSS selector, and we ask it to find the button element. And when we have the button element, we use the click method on the button element to trigger that click event handler. And once we've done that, well, now we need to verify that the count actually did increment. So how do we do that? Well, we go ahead and look for the paragraph element, the p tag, in our markup. And when we have that, we can use this special assertion method that's built into bUnit called markup matches. And here we ask it to verify that the markup of the p element, the p tag, now matches this text here. And obviously we wanted to have current count be one now. And well, as you can see, the test does run. We can run it again just to prove that I'm not cheating here, and it does indeed run. So that's one way to write bUnit test. I actually have another one that I think is slightly, well, might be, it's actually a bit more cool, and it does help in certain areas. We can actually write our test in a Razor file instead. So let's have a look at how that looks. So here we are in a Razor file. So let me show you that. We are over here, we're in a countertest.razor. So that's a Razor file. You can also see it up here. No cheating here. And as we did before in our C# version, we inherit from test context. In this counter should increment when clicked test method, we, instead of calling render component, we call another method called render. And this method is slightly different because it takes a render fragment as input. And a render fragment, you can actually write those in line in your C# in your Razor files. It's quite mind-blowing the first time you see that. But basically, we have a render fragment here where we only tell the render fragment, well, you go ahead and render the counter component. And like before, we get a render fragment out of that. We do the same thing with finding the button and clicking it. And we also, down here in the search step, we find the paragraph element. But this time, we pass a render fragment to markup matches because it's just so much easier to write render fragments like this inline, where you get syntax highlighting and you don't have to escape things. So if we compare to the other test we had before, we had to escape, we have to like add double quotes to have a single quote and so on and so forth. this is just much more easy to work with. So this test also works, and you know, that's about it. So let's look at another. Let's go a bit more deep. Let's maybe not too deep, but let's just go ahead and have a look at with the weather forecast here. The weather forecast page or fetch data page, it will pull data from a server, right? So if you do a file new Blazor project, you will get a fetch data page that uses HTTP client. HTTP client is not great to deal with in testing because you know it's not easy to mock. You have to have a lot of extra stuff going on in there. But it's also really not great to use HTTP client directly in your Blazor components. You should pack those away in a service or an abstraction so that you can share that across components and you can add other stuff to that you might need later on. So what I've done here is I replaced my HTTP client with an iWeather data service, and the iWeather data service just has a get forecast method, and you know it, as you saw in the browser, it still works. But if they can see here, the implementation is just you're just wrapping away the uses of HTTP client, and it just worked like that. So how do we test something like that? Let me go and find my fetch data test. It's down here, and let's move that out of the way. We don't need to look at that right now. So the first thing we would like to do is, well, how do we actually inject something that is an iWeather data service into our component under test, the fetch data component? Well, it's quite simple, actually. You use the services collection that is part of a test context, the bUnit test context, and similar to what you would do in your program CS, where you can add services. In this case, we're going to add a singleton of type iWeather data service. And what service do we want to actually inject in there? Well, we have a test weather data service, and the test weather data service is just, you know, a list of statically constructed list of weather forecasts. So, and it's, by the way, the same as the one we have in the browser. So now we can go ahead and render the fetch data component. And in this case, we're going to use the find all method, which will return all the elements that match a CSS selector. So in this case, we're going to use the go into the T body, and then we're going to return all the table rows. So now we have a list of rows, and we can assert that we have indeed four rows found by the test. So another thing that you can very easily do with bUnit if you need to is to debug things. So one trick here is that if you set a breakpoint here, for example, and let's see, we can go up to our fetch data component and maybe throw a breakpoint in here. So if I want to verify this, I go and find my test in the test explorer. I right click that and choose debug. And if we would give it a quick second to rebuild here, it will spin up a debug session just like you can with regular unit tests, and we can use our F10 to step over. And once we hit the uninitialized, well, we take breakpoint takes us into the uninitialized async method. Now we are debugging in our component. We can inspect its variables. We have access to all the good things that you normally would expect. So setting up a context where you have a specific scenario for your component that you can't quite get to work, and you want to debug that, well, that's super easy for bUnit. Just write a unit test for it, set up the state that you want for your component, and then hit F5, but right-click the unit test and choose a debug. So let me continue with that. And if you hear somebody shouting in the background, that's just Homer cheering whenever my test passes. So that's very friendly, and I'm very, you know, that's very nice of me to have Homer there. Anyway, so let's go on and look at something a bit more advanced. So here I have a sortable weather forecast table. And you might notice that we can now sort our, you know, data by clicking on the column. You will also notice that when we do that, you will see up here in UL, we have the UL updated with values matching the current sort value. So now we're sorting by temperature in Fahrenheit and ascending order. And if you click again, you will see it sorting by descending order. So, and when we default go into the component, it sorts by dates in ascending order. So this is sort of one of the new features that is part of .NET in our Blazor in .NET 6 is that we can have that query string information bound directly to the component. So again, how would we test that? So let's go and find that test. Let's see, here we go. So in these tests, I've taken my services registration and moved it into the constructor of the test class, just so we don't have to repeat that in every test. So good practice, don't repeat yourself. You can move just common things up into a constructor, for example. And here we see that we are asking bUnit to render this component, and we are just setting in some values. So here I'm asking it to render the fetch data sorting component and set the sort column to summary and set the sort direction to descending. So sort column and sort direction, let's go ahead and have a look at what they are. So, well, actually, we need to go to the code behind there. So you can see we have two parameters here, sort direction and sort column, and they have this supply parameter from query. So, but the trick here is that since we are not really running in a browser, we don't have a query parameter to supply things from, so we... But with bUnit, you just supply the parameters like you would normally, and you can still test your component, even though it's using that supply parameter of query. So this will still work. And so this test will check that that the indicator in the table head is actually set, so the arrow pointing up or down when we're sorting by a column. So what we will do after we render our component and set the sorting direction to a sort column to summary and sort direction to descending is that we go ahead and ask our markup, can you find in my table head, can you find the fourth column table header? And here we then do assertion saying, well, now it should have the name summary with a downwards pointing arrow because it's descending. And you notice here we have a trim method added here just to remove any unnecessary white space that might be added. Another way you could do this is use the markup matches that automatically handles all that, removing on insignificant white space and basically doing a semantic comparison of HTML. I'm not going to go too much into that, but if you can, you're going to have a much easier time maintaining your test if you default to using markup matches instead of asserting against text or markup from your components. So another thing we might want to verify in our component is that it sorts the rows correctly. I'm not really going to cover this test because it basically just looks at the first row after we sorted a bunch. A more interesting thing to look at would be, well, after we actually go ahead and click the column heads, do the sorting happen as we expect? Well, we saw that just happen because I already wrote that test, I wrote that code, but here we have the test. So again, we render our component. We render it with no arguments passed into it, so it's going to use the default. It's going to be sorted by date and ascending order. Here, we're going to go ahead and then use the find method again to find the table head and then the fourth table column, and then going to find the anchor tag inside of that, the A link. And then we're going to, when we have that sorting link, we can click that, click it once, then it's sorted by summary ascending order, and then click it one more time, it's sorted by summary in a descending order. So we basically flip twice. And then we can go into our component under test again and say, give me in the table body the first row, and then the fourth column, or fourth cell in there. And then we can do a markup matches where we assert that it's now freezing. So if you see you click one here, click once, we click twice, and now it should be freezing on top. So obviously this is not a, there's many ways you can make this more strict and verify this, but this is just for demo purposes, I guess. A third thing we might want to test is, excuse me, that's off-road we were talking about earlier. Yeah, so another thing we can do is, well, when we click, we want our component to update the URL. So you can see it actually does this when I click around here, so it updates the URL. But how do we actually verify that? Well, bUnit comes with a bunch of fake implementations of real things that are part of Blazor. So one of them is a navigation manager that our fetch data component does indeed get injected into it. But we can't use the real one because the real navigation manager would expect a browser and so on and so forth. So we have a fake navigation manager built into bUnit. And you get that by asking the services collection to give me this required service. Well, you can also just use get service, but I digress. And then with the fake navigation manager, it's just a real navigation manager with additional testing stuff on top. And we can actually say, well, let's try to first construct that expected URL we want after we've sorted by summary, and if we're even going to click once, well, it was going to be ascending. So we want a get UI with query parameters where we have sort by set to summary and sort direction set to ascending. So with that expected UL created, we can go ahead and render our component. Again, find the fourth header column and click that one. And after we've done that, we can assert that the expected UI is indeed the first thing in the navigation manager's history. So let me check how my I am on time. Okay, so another thing that we do have is the filtering here. Filtering with a multi-select, which is a new feature as well in Blazor. So if you only want the date and the same way, talking about temperatures, you can sort of filter things away like this. So how do we write a test for that? Well, in bUnit, you can also change values in input elements and so on and so forth. So here we are rendering our computer component, fetch data, sorting, filtering. We find this select box we have over here. It has an ID of column filters. Once we have that, we can call the change method on that. And because we want to change it so that the date and the summary is selected, we pass in date and summary. So you can pass in an array of whatever type that the target of your change event handler is expecting. And so after we've done that, we can go ahead and say, give me all the table heads in the T head, columns in the T head, table head. And once we do that, we can assert that we only have two now instead of the default four. So next thing I want to show you is testing custom events. So a custom event is a new thing in Blazor, and a custom event, I have a very fancy button here that basically has a very fancy custom event handler on it for a very fancy custom event. And when that custom event is triggered, some additional UI is shown, a UL with some data from the custom event. So how do we test that? So let me go down to my fancy button test here. And the test looks like this. We new up our custom event args and pass in foo and bar to the custom properties. We render the fancy button. And then we go ahead and find the button. And when we have the button, we can use this new method called trigger event, where we pass in the name of our custom event and the arguments. After we've done that, we expect there to be a UL, an unordered list element in our markup, and we can use markup matches to verify that these things look right, that these are set correctly. And another thing that is part of bUnit, and I hope, let me know, Leila, if I still have time. But another thing that is part of bUnit I would like to talk about is a new way of controlling what components get it's instantiated and created during the rendering. So if we go back to the counter example here, you will notice that I don't have the paragraph inline. I have a fancy paragraph instead where we pass the current count into a component. So the component tree or the render tree for the counter component will be counter, and then it will have a page title as a child component, and it will have a fancy paragraph as a child component. But if we don't want to render this part of the test, maybe because it comes from a third party, maybe because it's you're using a third-party library, but you don't really want to test the third-party library code as part of your unit test because you don't want to test your own code, right? So this here is this provides us with a way to replace this. So let me quickly show how that works, because I feel like I'm getting very short on time. So if we scroll down a bit. So what you can do, you have something called component factors in a test context, and it has an add method. Component factors is what controls what gets instantiated. So here we are telling it to, if you see a fancy paragraph, replace it with a dummy paragraph. And what is a dummy paragraph? Well, dummy paragraph is just a simple component that just have the same public parameters as the fancy paragraph. And when we run that test, well, now we don't have any output from the original fancy component, but we do have a dummy component in our component tree, and we can find that dummy component in component tree by calling find component. And once we've done that, we can get we get a render component back, and the render component is a similar like a render fragment, but it also has an instance property. An instance property gives us access to the instance of the component, the dummy paragraph in this case, and we can now do an assert that the right value was passed to our fancy paragraph component in our counter component, but it was instead captured by the dummy paragraph, obviously. So we now can assert that count is one instead of looking in the markup. And there's an extra method here that sort of shows you that has component, fancy component, should return false now. Obviously, this is not ideal. You don't want to write a whole bunch of dummy versions of your components you want to replace or remove from your component tree. But so to get around that, I've started working on a mocking and stopping library for bUnit, where you are able to do this instead, add stop, and then you say stop out fancy paragraph. And the only change we have from the previous test is that now we go and set a find component stop of fancy paragraph, and instead of having the real count parameter on it, the stop paragraph has a condition of a called parameters, where we can go and look up all the parameters that were originally passed to fancy paragraph. So this is very much still in preview, but it's something I hope that we will be able to improve on in the near future. So I don't think I can steal any more of your time. So thank you very much for joining. Here are some links to stuff that I do and where you can find me. Some shout out to bUnit sponsors, Progress Telerik and Circfusion. They've been with me for quite a while and it helps a lot. So thank you very much to them for sponsoring open source. It's really appreciated. So if there's time for any questions, I'm here to answer them.
Thank you, Eagle. I've just had a look and I don't think there are any questions. I'm just checking various feeds. I must say, I kept hearing Homer Go and I was like, oh, it's that new feature that you can set. And I was like, oh, that's so cool. It made me smile. So thank you.
My pleasure.
I don't think there are any questions whatsoever. That demo is all on your GitHub, I take it?
I think I need to go and flip that public switch, but yeah, it will be in 5 minutes. Yeah.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much, Eagle, and have a wonderful rest of your day and look after that cough.
Yeah, thank you. And you too.
Take care. All right. Cheerio. Bye.
Bye-bye.